Good morning, everyone. How are you doing? If we haven't had a chance to meet yet, I'm Caroline Kyung-a-Hong. I am an associate professor of English at Queen's College. I'm also the director slash lead PI of the Queen's College AAAPI project, aka QCAP. I'm also on the RE board and the symposium planning committee. Basically, too many hats. But I'm really so happy to be here today, and thank you again. I want to echo Sonia's thanks just for coming out so early on a Friday at a very busy time of the year. We really appreciate you being present and engaged with us today. Before I introduce our wonderful roundtable, am I audible okay for everyone in the room? Thank you. I just want to add and emphasize to that list of acknowledgments that Sonia made. I want to take a moment to express our deep love and gratitude for our interim executive director, Sonia Munshi. Yay, Sonia. So I really want to note, as Sonia said, so much of what ARI has been doing has been this collective, collaborative effort. But truly, none of this stuff would have been possible without Sonia at the helm. Without her leadership, her labor, her care, and some of you know all the things that ARI has been doing this year that's sort of been new and experimental, right? From this symposium to the brown bag, the monthly brown bag series, to ARI Reads, to the faculty development seminar that some of you are participants in this semester. And some of you, just to embarrass Sonia for a minute, some of you saw from the ARI newsletter that she was named. she was recently featured on the City and State New York's, what is it called, Power of Diversity Asian 100 list. As number 100, though she is number one in our hearts, right? But for those of you who know Sonia or have worked with Sonia for a while now, you know how much she has done and continues to do to serve our local communities and to help grow and support Asian American studies and critical ethnic studies at CUNY and beyond. So just thank you again, Sonia, for everything. We really want to thank you. Okay. Back to our opening roundtable. So if you look at our program for today, you may have noted that we do have a second roundtable later this afternoon that is all about reflections and looking back at the histories of Asian American studies at CUNY, which is, of course, super important and vital to the work that we do, right? To access our collective institutional memory and to know where we've come from, where we've been, right? In order to know where we're headed or where we want to go. But we also, on the planning committee, we also recognize that too often we start things like this with that conversation about the past, right, about our histories, and then we run out of time and we kind of stall there. And we never get to that next part, right, of what do we want to do next. So we really wanted to be intentional in flipping the script a bit and beginning today oriented toward our futures and sort of holding that as the frame for the rest of the day as well. So towards sustaining our past and present work and imagining future possibilities and collaborations. So with that framing in mind, we wanted to invite brilliant colleagues from across CUNY, from different CUNY institutions, to help us dream these futures, right, by sharing from their specific positions and experiences. And we're so grateful and excited that these wonderful folks were available and willing to participate on this roundtable. So you can read their full bios in the program. The QR code is up here as well. But let me introduce them briefly, and then I'll sit down and we can get to our questions. So we have Francisco Delgado, who is a proud Chamorro, and through his maternal grandmother, a member of the Tonawanda Band of Seneca, and he is an assistant professor of English at BMCC. We have Aliyah and Rajit Singh, who is an assistant professor of Caribbean studies in the Africana Studies Department at Brooklyn College. She is the co-author of Dugla in the 21st Century, Adding to the Mix, a study of race and the mixed race Dugla identity in the Caribbean. And then we have Sokantari Sway, who was born in a refugee camp in Thailand shortly after her parents fled Cambodia after the fall of the Khmer Rouge regime. They were sponsored to come to the US and resettled in the Bronx, where she grew up. In addition to publishing a poetry collection titled Apsara, New York in 2017, her memoir archive, Put It on Record, is forthcoming this fall from Willow Books. We also have Zora Said, whose poetry and essays have been published in numerous anthologies and journals. She co-founded Upset Press, a Brooklyn-based nonprofit indie press with poet Robert Boris. Zora is a distinguished lecturer at CUNY's Macaulay Honors College. Zora couldn't be with us in person today, but she did send a video with some of her remarks, which we'll play for you toward the end of the roundtable. And then please note, unfortunately, Tari Ham couldn't join us today, but we send her our love and care. Hi, beautiful roundtablers from this vantage point. All right, so we have three questions for our opening roundtable participants, and we'll take each question at a time. So one question, three rounds, and each of our participants will take a few minutes to answer each question. And then at the end, we'll have a little bit of time for the audience, for you all to chat with each other and share your thoughts as well. So the first question we like to start with is about each of your origin stories. So take just a few minutes. I know we could be here all day hearing about each of your origin stories, but just a few minutes to please tell us, how did you first come to the scholarly and creative work that you do?
Hi, good morning. It's so wonderful to be here. Thank you to Sonia and the committee for inviting me. So I'll go first. So I must say that I am a Caribbeanist. My training is in gender and women's studies, but in all of my work, I seek to center the Caribbean as an epistemological space, a space of knowledge creation by Caribbean people, about Caribbean people, for Caribbean people, and of course the world. So I must say that, you know, first. But of course, coming to my work, and then I'll get to how it's situated in Asian American studies. But it's interesting. Interestingly enough, I had to leave the Caribbean. I was born in the Caribbean in Trinidad and Tobago. I had to leave the Caribbean to actually find the Caribbean and find myself. In Trinidad and Tobago, I'm understood as a Douglas. And the Dogla is the Caribbean person of mixed African and Indian descent, and it speaks to our colonial legacies, right? Africans and Indians brought to the Caribbean space to work on sugar plantations as enslaved and indentured laborers. And of course, that mixing, which would ultimately happen, right, producing, of course, the Dogla. And in Trinidad, I am understood, sometimes forcibly, as Dogla. But then I left Trinidad at the age of 17, 18 to attend college here in New York. And I did go to Brooklyn College, where I teach now. And there are a lot of things I had to reconcile, particularly not just entering into the United States and, of course, New York, but this brand new system of racialization that I was not accustomed to, right? So while in Trinidad, I could be understood as Dougla, in New York, I was Black. And I experienced Blackness, and with that, of course, anti-Blackness. What's interesting is that as a child, I experienced anti-Blackness in Trinidad, but I didn't have the, you know, the language to describe it. It would take leaving Trinidad to very much understand that, and again, understand myself as a Black body here in the US. And of course, today I describe myself as a Black Douglas Caribbean woman. And again, that understanding would not have come without me leaving the Caribbean space. And then, of course, I returned. So when I returned, there was a lot more reconciliation to take place as well. And I remember sitting in a seminar room at the University of the West Indies with one of my friends, Dr. Sue Ann Barrett. We were completing our PhDs, and we were spending the night in the seminar room, which we were not supposed to do. And I'm, of course, Douglas. My father's of Indian descent. My maternal great-great-grandmother, Bunadi, she was an indentured laborer. She came from India to Trinidad. My mother's of African descent. So I'm understood as a, you know, as a 50-50 Douglas. Suwan understood as a multiracial Douglas, Indian, African plus. Another colleague, also multiracial. And I began to share my experiences of being sometimes forcibly seen as Douglas in Trinidad. You know, maybe because my hair isn't curly enough, right? And but then in the U.S., I'm being understood as Black, experiencing, you know, anti-Blackness, Blackness, you know, very much, you know, defining myself as Black as well. So we began to have this conversation, and I said something like, well, maybe I'm just not mixed enough. And, you know, from there, our research, our central research question was born, right? And we began our work on Dougla and mixedness, right? And not just, you know, mixedness. Well, let me just rephrase, right? Much work on mixedness, it situates, of course, the global north and mixedness with whiteness. But we wanted to situate, of course, mixedness that can occur in the global south, right? And that's how, you know, we came to this work. It was very much, you know, I came to this work, it was very much personal. And again, I had to leave the Caribbean space to get to it.
Yeah, no, I have a great origin story. It's like superhero. I was born in a refugee camp in Thailand after my parents had fled Cambodia across the jungle and borders. And we were sponsored by the International Rescue Committee, and they resettled us in the Bronx, and that's where I grew up. So I'm very much New York City. I don't call myself Cambodian American. I call myself a Cambodian New Yorker, because, you know, like, I would die for the city. And as far as like how I got here, I'm a CUNY baby through and through. I did both my bachelor's and my master's at City College. I teach there now as well. I'm currently a PhD candidate in English at the Graduate Center. How I came to this was pretty easy. Thinking about my positionality as someone who is Southeast Asian and not really understanding what that meant. And because our diaspora had only been in this country since the late 70s as a result of the influx of refugees because of the Vietnam War and bombing Cambodia and then the secret war in Laos and so forth, it really doesn't give us much in the way of resources and narratives outside of one that is war-based. And so because a lot of the Cambodians and a lot of the Southeast Asian refugees that came over were living with a post-traumatic stress disorder, it's not like we as their children had access to information about who we were, why we were here, and then, you know, what else to, how to begin to talk about that. And so for me, it was how to differentiate myself from East Asians, because it seemed that we got lumped in with them when, you know, there are communities who have been here much longer with resources, with a different kind of history, whereas we came here under duress. And so making that distinction was one very important for me. The next was, what is the story that my parents are not telling me? And so I distinctly remember being at City College in the library, going to the Asian section and looking for Cambodian narratives, and I found that most of the literature about Cambodians was about the Khmer Rouge, about political history, or Angkor Wat, our famous temples. And so, you know, immediately I saw that there was this dichotomy of how we were being talked about. And so, you know, I was like, okay, well, let me explore this. And that became like my thesis, and I ended up getting a scholarship, and, you know, that became like the focal point of my work, all starting from personal place. But that wasn't enough for me, because I didn't see enough of narratives, and not just war and about, you know, coming over here. I wanted to see us, like, you know, be in love and, you know, do dumb things, you know, like hang out and barbecue. So I actually am a published writer, and so I write poetry, essays, opera libretti, choral pieces, and I actually have a music background as well. So for me, it was just about inquiry and curiosity and using whatever means of genre and spaces to collaborate and explore. And part of it was just, I didn't want to just study, I wanted to add to the literature. And so I have, you know, sorry, little infomercial, my book of poetry, as well as flyers for my upcoming book, which for me is, I call a memoir archive, because I'm attempting to create an archive of my people's entry point here, only because if you go to the archive and look for anything Cambodian, it's all killing fields. And in fact, I went to the New York Times archive and found the documents, the supporting documents for that film of, you know, with Sidney Schoenberg and Dith Pran, the two characters for whom the whole narrative is based around. And I was like, okay, this is a starting point, but you know, what from there? And then starting to think about the way that we were placed in these impoverished areas along with Black and Latinx communities and the kind of Black-Asian solidarity work that really needs to happen, that is starting to happen, but you know, needs to continue. And so, you know, how can what I do as an academic and as a you know artistic practice come together and be useful in a variety of spaces. And I also love teaching. I feel very passionate about that. So for me, it's I'm not really sure how I managed to do all these things because I get a little tired. But this is it. Just feels like this is my life's work to find all the places where I can like permeate with the information, but also like how can I take it and work it into my own practices and what I do. And how is that, like, this idea of the refugee having to adapt and to take those things in and to make it work and to move on and to not just survive but thrive.
Good morning, everyone. I have a whole bunch of notes because I didn't want to neglect any names. So before Sonia was talking about the importance of giving thanks, I want to make sure that I thank all the people who, in some ways, factor into my own non-superhero-esque, unfortunately, origin story. Although you only hear about villain origin stories, I feel, these days. But my research, very similar to my fellow panelists, as well as my creative work, what it does is right now I'm examining how indigenous Pacific communities are impacted by U.S. militarization in the region. But getting away from just that singular story, I want to show that joy, and I want to show how they forge kinship and belonging amongst one another. Across geographies, across time, and this is tied to my own family's background as a military family. My dad is a veteran, my grandfathers were veterans, many of my uncles were veterans. It was presumed that I would too enlist and become a veteran one day. I chose a different track. My grandfathers are both Chamorro, who are the indigenous people of Micronesia, or you know, in that region of the Pacific. They're from the island of Guam, more specifically. My maternal grandmother is Tonawanda Band of Seneca, who are the indigenous people of upstate New York. And my dad's mom is Japanese. And they all met because of the military. So my work is critical of the military as this infrastructure, as this tool to build empire and displace people. But at the same time, I also readily always acknowledge the fact that I exist. I am here today with all of you because of the military. So writing is a way for me to explore this history, explore my own identity, to connect with my culture, even though I did not grow up on the Tonawanda Reservation or on the island of Guam, and to connect with you know folks, probably not unlike many of you, who are on like a similar journey of this reconnection and this celebration of culture beyond just the you know stories of trauma that many of our communities are associated with. But I also need to admit that I came to this work through the guidance of a lot of former professors. I never took a class on Asian American literature. I now teach a class on Asian American literature, which I'm very proud of. But I went to college in the early to mid 2000s. They were very hard to come by. They weren't as prevalent, unfortunately. So as an undergraduate, I was a creative writing major. I wrote a story called The Rise of Kid Tokyo, which was about a professional wrestler who was forced to play a stereotype in order to move on to the next level in his profession. And I'm embarrassed by the story, it's not that good. But at the time, it put me in contact with an Asian American professor named Heinz Insu Finkel, who has published some books on his own, and he met with me outside of class and suggested I research this field and my culture and other Asian Pacific cultures more deeply. So he suggested a book called Asian American Literature by Elaine H. Kim, which came out in the 1980s. But it's great as a canonical text. It introduced me to a lot of canonical Asian American literature writers like Maxine Hong Kingston, of course, Amy Tan, who I knew because you know the Joy Luck Club was so big in the early 90s, Louis Chu, as well as Carlos Bulasan. So I was you know, reading through this book and exploring some of those writers on my own. But then at Brooklyn College, where I did my master's, I'm also a CUNY child in some ways, That was the first time where I read a book by an Asian American author in a class setting, and to have that kind of guidance. And that book was John Okada's Nono Boy, which became the subject of my MA thesis, which was only made possible and successfully completed through the guidance of Joseph Enten, who is an English department faculty member. He taught the class that I read the book, and he oversaw this MA thesis that eventually became my first academic publication. So I'm very proud that my first publication in academia was about Nono Boy. And then at Stony Brook, where I did my PhD, I took my first class exclusively devoted to Asian American literature, and that was taught by Jeffrey Santa Anna, who would go on to chair my dissertation, which looked at how indigenous writers and Asian American writers turned to the dystopian genre to address settler colonialism. And in 2014, you know, if you said something like, oh, authors of color use dystopia to address racism, people's like, what? Now it's so passe, everyone's saying it. But when, you know, it was kind of cool and novel at the time. But what happened was I got very tired of dystopia. And instead I wanted to focus on hope, which to me, and to many of us, I think, is tied to community and kinship and belonging. So that is really what I'm focusing on these days in both my academic as well as in my creative work. Thank you.
I love this so much. I'm so happy right now. And I already love how much joy and hope and love is emerging as a theme on this roundtable. My own research is on comedy and comics, so that's like straight up right up my alley. That's like exactly what I want to bring to this work as well. I think maybe in the interest of time and also to let you all sort of sit with this a little bit, I'm gonna combine questions 2 and 3, if that's okay. I'm just gonna make that call. So to think about one, how do you see your work in relationship to Asian American studies now, in this moment, since you told us a little bit about your origin story? So how do you see your work in relationship to Asian American studies now? And then as we turn towards thinking about its growth, its futures at CUNY, what are 1 to 2 critical issues that you believe we need to center and or take up in that work? So the question is sort of, we did the past question, so now we're sort of combining the present and the future, because your present work is, of course, part of our future at CUNY. So we'll start there. Does anyone want to start? Lilia? Yeah?
It's funny because I never thought my work was in relation to Asian American studies. So thank you to, I think it was like Sonia, Linda, Caroline, those persons who had put together the Building Asian American Studies summer program in 2016. I had seen this email. I was an adjunct here at BMCC, and I see this email to be a part of this summer Yale-long program, and I'm like, I want to do that, but how? And I saw in the details that work on Indo-Caribbeans, if you're working on that, you could be included. And I'm like, well, listen, if there's a space for Indo-Caribbeans, there's a space for Douglas. And if there's a space for Douglas, there's a space for me. Mm-hmm. And I applied, and I got in, and I met these wonderful people, and they never let me go. I was thinking about that. And I see Preeti over there as well. We're all part of this program. And I never let them go either, so that's why I'm here. I remember, you know, sitting down, trying to create this argument as to why the Douglas should be, you know, included, you know, and why the Douglas should be part of Asian American studies, you know, not just in centering the South Asian diaspora, but also, you know, these double diaspora people, right, Indo-Caribbeans, and particularly mixedness, you know, in the global South, and what happens when these, you know, mixed bodies then, you know, cross borders, you know, within, you know, to the North American space, you know, what happens when the Douglas encounters these understandings of blackness and anti-blackness, for instance, right? And I just want to, you know, I didn't say this before, you know, even that term Douglas, it is steeped in anti-blackness, right? It speaks to, of course, this idea of, you know, blackness, you know, diluting the purity or dissolving the purity of Indianness. That term Douglas, which comes from the Bhojpuri, it actually denotes son of a dog, son of a whore, bastard, right? That is where that comes from. That is my, I don't want to say that's my legacy, right? Because the connotations have very much shifted, but it is steeped in anti-blackness. And again, I remember having to think about, well, how do I apply to this program? You know, how do I situate Dougla within that work? And I do see, you know, my work as a great part of Asian American studies, again, in centering not just Indo-Caribbeans, not just centering the South Asian diaspora, but how mixedness, you know, has occurred in the global South. And again, you know, how these mixed race people then have to reconcile, you know, blackness, anti-blackness, you know, within the United States of America. In terms of the growth of Asian American studies, I think that these are issues that, you know, should be, could be at the forefront, you know, as well, right? Mixedness, understandings, again, you know, of, you know, identity, for instance, but also interdisciplinarity. In that this semester, for the first time, I taught a class at Brooklyn College called Asian the Caribbean. And it was actually created by the director of the Caribbean Studies program. I taught the class. Professor Pan, to my left, was excited about the class. It was cross-listed with American Studies. And I think, you know, even, you know, at CUNY, when, you know, where enrollment is very low across the board, and particularly in my Department of Africana Studies, we see cross-listing as a way to not just fill classes, but these courses then become available to, you know, great, you know, more students. So maybe seeing where our classes can be cross-listed, because I think Asian American Studies is very much interdisciplinary, you know, in that way, right? And I hope to run the class again, and this time cross-listed with history as well, for instance, because it is history. It is our history.
I have a few different answers for this question, the second question, about my relationship to Asian American Studies. To me, I think of it in, like, a three-pronged approach, as a teacher, as a mentor, as a writer. So as a teacher, my work in Asian American Studies is very much tied into that Asian American literature course that I mentioned earlier, and making that available to students, and you know, selecting texts that would speak more strongly, more relevantly to their lived experiences and cultural backgrounds. And I really have to thank the wonderful folks at the ABI seminar for making this apparent to me, the importance of that, of appealing to students' backgrounds. And so what I usually do with this Asian American literature class is I root it in this wonderful city that we live in, New York City. And we read books like Native Speaker by Chung Ray Lee, or Bharati Mukherjee's Jasmine, which is set in Flushing. And if anyone is in, if anyone's from Flushing or lives in Flushing, the narrator does have a not-so-favorable opinion of it, just be advised. And more recently, Brown Girls by Daphne Andriadis, which is excellent, and students love that book. So as a teacher, I you know, teach these courses, but I also, in my composition classes, foreground writers from Asian Pacific Islander backgrounds. So that means, of course, Amy Tan's mother tongue, right? Lovely. So perfect. But also more contemporary writers like Matthew Salices, who writes about how you can tell your story in a setting, in a space like a college classroom that isn't maybe too amenable to you telling your story. Or a writer like Jenny Zhang, who writes very wonderfully and powerfully and with a lot of humor about cultural appropriation, which is something that you know, Provost Wong was talking about to start our day. As a mentor, I participate in a lot of different mentoring programs. I'll mention one. It's the NEMLA Job Clinic program, NEMLA standing for Northeast Modern Language Association. And I find that over the last 5 years, I am constantly partnered with Asian American Studies students, or students who are studying Asian American literature. And I love that I get to, in some ways, talk about my own experiences and help them navigate this, for those of us who know, very treacherous space that is the job market in academia. And I take that work very seriously, and I always give them my email. I meet them for coffee outside of the conference, because sometimes, you know, conversations that we need to have need to happen away from everyone else at the conference. Lastly, in my own research, as I said before, it starts with my family and my own culture and wanting to explore it and, you know, make space for it in my life every day, but also in like this, again, sometimes not too welcoming space, you know, that is like the college campus.
Francisco, did you want to share the 1 to 2 critical issues for the futures? Did you want to emphasize? Yeah, sorry, I threw a curveball at you.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And it's something that Sonia actually mentioned earlier. There is this really, I do a lot of stuff with Native Indigenous studies as well, Native Indigenous literatures. So this connection between land displacement of Native peoples, Indigenous peoples in the Pacific, and this issue of labor exploitation, right, that is very common in a lot of Asian American studies scholarship. I think there is a link, and it shows how even though Native Indigenous Asian American peoples are often racialized in different ways, there is a connection there. So I think questions that really highlight those issues and give students a chance to explore them and give us a chance to explore them as well would be something that we should definitely take up in the future.
So as far as like where I stand, I never even considered myself Asian American studies or even the humanities, and I'm actually going to a humanities fellowship luncheon right after this. And then I'm coming right back. There are a lot of things I know that we were limited on time, but first I wanted to say a little anecdote of how, God, this is very disconcerting. About 20 years ago, I was in an Asian studies class, and we got to the section on Southeast Asia. The Vietnam War got one sentence within the whole class. And so, forget Cambodia or anything relating to that. And I was very disturbed by that. And that was 20 years ago. And now I'm sitting here in front of you talking about Asian American studies futures, which is incredible to me. The other thing, you were talking about Amy Tan's mother tongue. So in my new book, I have decided, I think that story has been taught a lot. Yeah. And we could teach something a little contemporary. So I've actually, part of the work that I do as a writer within academia is I want to put work that will be used. I don't want to just be studying other people's work, but instead contributing to that literature. So mine is actually, I call it The Shape of My Mother's Dialect. And it's about her language and literacy. And it's something that's meant to, for those who are tired of mother tongue, as just something, just to borrow, to replace for a moment. And I actually analyze my own poetry, which I write in my mother's dialect because she speaks a very accented English. There's a poem called At Least Prostitutes Bring Home Money. And it's, why you come home late in the dark, you wear the stupid big boot, no job where you want me, And so instead I actually analyze that and how we don't even get to see someone like her who, works at a hotel and speaks in that way, to see a literature that features a woman like that speaking that way and to legitimize that. So that's the way that I work, which is like, what can I put out there that could also be used in the classroom? Not in my own, of course, because that's weird. But so that's the sort of thing that I'm doing. As far as like the larger, the larger things, critical refugee studies, I think, is like really great, and what's happening right now. I guess it's more like California based, but Yenle Spiritu, and you've got Kataria Om, who is terrific, like one of the first Cambodian scholars, really, with a PhD in the U.S. And I think the way that they're situating the idea of the refugee, whether it is Southeast Asian or from other parts of the world, I think that's a new way of thinking about our positionality in this country. So that's important. But I think also disaggregating the data for Asian Americans is so important. CRAC, Southeast Asian Action Resource Action Center. They do so much of their work around trying to transform, change, influence public policy. And what you'll notice is with Vietnamese, Cambodian, Lao, Hmong communities, we have actually as a diaspora, our numbers for education is much lower than even Black communities as a whole in the United States. And yet, when you see a lot of like scholarships and things, you know, Asian Americans are, you know, are still left out of certain things because we get lumped in with a lot of, you know, the East Asian and South Asian who come here and who are highly educated. And most of the Cambodians who came here, 90% of them, 90% of artists and intellectuals were killed. So we have a lot of farmers and folks who did not have like literacy, language literacy here. So keeping those things in mind, you know, for me, it's always about making that distinction and educating. Educating is such a huge part of what I do. So it's not just in the classroom, but wherever I go, whether it's with the writing or even, you know, in a space like this. So yeah, thank you.
So I think what I'll do now is I'll play the remarks from Zora.
Good morning. My name is Zora Said. I'm a distinguished lecturer here at Macaulay Honors College at CUNY. My origin story in Asian American studies really starts at Hunter College in post 9/11 era, when Asian American studies, the studies program there was under the leadership of Robert Koo. I had a great opportunity to teach Arab American literature, West Asian American literature, and film, Central Asian film and literature, Central Asian diaspora, to be more clear. For me, the time was that 7-year period where I was adjuncting and given a lot of freedom to create courses and initiate things, I really was able to be more, think more inclusively about the term Asian American. Definitely post 9/11 time was very important to making connections with the war in Iraq, the war in Afghanistan, with the war in Vietnam, and the Korean, the war in Korea. So I think that that experience really teaching from diaspora and thinking through these things with my students and really acknowledging and including the CUNY student body into their experiences, into the courses that were offered, I was really able to see, or I should say, I learned how to articulate a way to talk about my experience and the experience of the community I was interested in, that I have linguistic and cultural access to and emotional access to, and articulate it within the language and the critical lens of Asian American studies and what youth scholars in the field. So for me, that was my origin story. I ended up actually not writing my dissertation on the Afghan American diaspora. I did edit a co-edit an anthology of Afghan American writings. Maybe the introduction carried the kernel or like the idea for my dissertation. But my path took me elsewhere to Langston Hughes in Central Asia. And I feel very much so that if I just 1 minute, let me set up the screen.
My research was on Langston Hughes in Central Asia with Central Asian writers here in this photo. My research ended up being more about his friendships and relationships with the poets around him, Ali Tokumbayov, Ghafar Ghulam, Shelley Kekalov. But I think this history of Langston Hughes, informed by Black internationalism and
the relationship. And I feel like much of this had a lot to do with my point of inquiry, the way I was reading the photographs, the way I was reading the work with Arthur Kupfer, actually. The way he was, he photographed Central Asians for me was informed a lot by my Asian American studies background. So I feel like in some ways, even though this is Central Asian, this is these, this kind of conversation is also important in Asian American studies, where we can use a framework of earlier scholars, theorists, but really bring in and stretch and find those points of intersection, right? We have intersectionality. I call it more of an entwined poetics, which is the work I do. And for me, the way I was able to interact with the Hughes archives was because of my own experience as a Central Asian diaspora from the particular time that Hughes had come to Central Asia. So this is my great uncle. And this is a little bit in the chapbook that I had published through Lost and Found. I spoke about having access to the Hughes book, being able to translate. Because in the diaspora, we were able to preserve a particular type of language, a particular type of reading and writing the alphabet that was not preserved in Georgia itself because it was elitized. So I want to say that for me, the future of Asian American studies is in that sense of openness, of intersection, right? Creating those sort of crossover moments and being open to not only new immigrant groups that would identify or benefit from a larger community of Asian Americans or Asian American studies. I think that sense of openness, especially at CUNY, would be essential to the kind of politics we have now, right? There has been a lot of work with African-American and Asian-American connections, which I think is highly valuable. There's an entire field of Central Asian diaspora, Central Asian American, Uzbek American, Kazakh American. The whole art scene that's being built around that. So I think having access to multiple layers of migration in the Arab American community, the Iranian and the Afghan American communities as well, and kind of incorporating that into the sort of foundational work of Asian American studies is essential to keep growing. Politicizing Asian American studies is important because it politicized me. When I went to the Asian American Writers Workshop and interned, that's where I was able to learn, again, a language, a way to articulate my experience, to see power dynamics and to see those connections. So for me, the future of Asian American studies, that's meaning, and I'm really grateful for this opportunity to sit and be part of this larger conversation. It is important to plug into multiple channels, multiple, being open to art. I always feel that visual art and poetry in some ways work really to deconstruct or fragment these colonial discourses, so a way of seeing. So I think being open to the world of multimedia, art, film, of course, and the different layers of new communities is really important for CUNY and for Asian American studies.
Thank you all. Just one more round of applause for all four of our roundtable participants. So we're now going to transition and open it up to all of you, but not with a traditional Q&A. Ha-ha. Bear with us. We're going to cut just a few minutes into our break time. Since it's the morning, we're still fresh. We're okay, right? So here what I want to do is I want to borrow from Eve Tuck's Indigenous Feminist Approach to Facilitating Q&A. And I'm actually going to ask you, I'm going to set a timer in a second for 5 minutes for you all to talk with each other. So talk among yourselves. And then if you have questions or questions or comments for our roundtable or for all of us in this room to add to this conversation on the futures of Asian American Studies at CUNY, we ask you to take this 5 minutes as you chat with each other to peer review your questions and comments. We've all been at Q&As where people ask questions and comments we wish they hadn't. Right, or wish they had checked in with someone before they'd said them out loud. I'll say a little bit more at the end of 5 minutes, but I'm going to go ahead and set the timer now. So go ahead and chat with each other for 5 minutes, peer review those questions and comments.